I just got a request from a church friend in Chicago who's doing some type of a report on missionaries. So I thought I'd make a quick video. Quick, remind myself quick, so that others can benefit as well. But my name is Brother Mitch, Mitch Metzger on YouTube, GoMitch2, and Facebook page as well. And I've been serving here in the Philippines since 1988, 36 years now. And I'm married to a Filipina for about 32 years, and I have two older daughters that live in St. Louis, Missouri. But I live outside of Manila, Philippines, about 12 million population Manila. The Philippines is about the size of California from north to south, but it's made up of 7,000 islands. And we're about 80% nominal Catholic and about 10% born-again evangelical and about 10% Muslim in this country. And amen. Okay, my first question here is, how and when did you receive the calling to be a missionary? Well, first of all, I gave my life to Jesus when I was 20 years old in the U.S. Marines in Millington, Tennessee. And then the military sent me to the Philippines and Japan almost every year. And it while I was in Japan and in the Philippines, 1986 and again in 1987, that's when God was speaking to me about missions and about evangelism and about finishing up my four-year military career and then coming back to the Philippines. And that's what I did. I came back to the Philippines when I was 24 years old as a single guy and started here, and now it's been 28 other countries and all 50 states in America since then. So everything started God's call on my life while I was still in my job, my military job, experiencing volunteering in my free time. Okay, second question is, what was your reaction? What impact did it have when you received God's call? Well, in 1986, I remember hearing a sermon from Ephesians about the different ministries or the different places in the church. They got pastors and preachers, pastors and prophets and apostles and evangelists and teachers. And that spoke to me, that particular Ephesians 4 passage about evangelists and evangelism. And then I was looking at a map of the Philippines once, and I sensed God was speaking to me about evangelism and missions. And then there was another time I was folding Christian literature, getting ready to go into the streets as a two-year Christian, and God was speaking to me about evangelism and missions. There was another time I was reading a basic brochure on tourism in the Philippines. Not even a spiritual thing, but a tourism brochure, and God was speaking to me about evangelism in Asia and missions, etc. And then I came across a verse once that said, every step of a righteous man is ordered by the Lord. And so God spoke to me basically those four different ways, five different ways, as an early two-year Christian and a two-year Marine about missions and evangelism. And so I remember I was just, you know, questioning, saying, okay, Lord, is this really what you want me to do? Because if I leave the military after 4 years and step out into the unknown, you know, it's a big step. And so I just sensed God's presence and assurance that everything was going to be okay. So I finished up my 4 years and then came to the Philippines and started my missionary career here. Number three, when and where did your first missionary trip take place? Well, I'll answer this in two ways. My first missionary trips were while I was still a Marine, as they would send me to different places like Japan for 4 months and then the Philippines for 2 months, then North Carolina for 2 years, and then Japan again for 4 months, and then the Philippines again for 2 months, and to Okinawa, Japan for a week, and Reno, Nevada for a week, and Washington State, Whidbey Island for 4 months. So the military would send me to these different places, and I was always engaged in evangelistic activity with local churches and local ministries. So my first missionary trips were during my free time as a Marine. But the second way I'll answer the question is after I got out of the military and got on an airplane and came to the Philippines. My first official trip was with a team of 8 of us, and we traveled around the Philippines, island to island to island, 1 week, 1 week, 1 week, 1 week, doing evangelism, dramas in the streets, open air preaching with crowds, in classrooms, in schools, in basketball courts, literature distribution, public speaking, one-on-one evangelism at bus stations and boat piers, and that was all in 1988 as I started my missionary career as a 24-year-old, okay? Okay, what was your experience on your first trip? I just answered that. Island to island to island in 1988 with my Youth with a Mission Discipleship Training School classmates, okay? Number 5, what was your overall experience been like as a missionary, both positive and negative? Overall experience, positive, or fulfilling, I guess. Amazing. It's been 28 countries. I just even finished Malaysia and Singapore last week. I was away from home for 13 days all the way across Malaysia, so I have a lot of experiences, a lot of new stories, engaged with people, talking and interacting with people, experiencing different foods, etc. I've preached in all 50 states in America. So fulfilling. Someone once said, if you have a job you enjoy, you'll never work another day in your life. And so I guess I have a job that I enjoy, and I haven't worked another day in my life. Although, yeah, I'm working all the time. This is working. And so, amen. So that's been fulfilling, okay? Satisfying, fruitful, you know, hitting the mark of your high calling in Christ Jesus. Wow, amen. On the negative side, I guess in my earlier years as a fresh, new Youth with a Mission missionary, learning to interact and decision make and as a team was difficult. Being very typical independent American, making decisions on your own. In missions, you often work as a team and you have to ask the opinions or the ideas of the others on your team, like what should we do now or where should we go now? How should we solve this and how can we pay this bill and what do you guys think and what do you think? And then compiling that input from as many as 5 to 15 others and then deciding. That was difficult for me in the beginning, until learning how to do that and the importance of doing that. So that would be my negative experiences, a relational teamwork decision problem solving type stuff, okay? It's been a lot easier since the late 80s with that sort of a thing now. So what has impacted you the most in this calling? Impacted, I guess, discovering my giftings. In the very beginning, in the 80s, it was just all about evangelism. I didn't have to worry about anything except going out for evangelism, witnessing, passing out literature, inviting people to church, inviting people to Bible study, a little bit of preaching on Sundays, that sort of a thing. And it wasn't more than 5 years later, I started growing in leadership skills and administration skills. Wow, I never thought I'd be enjoying and doing a lot of administration. But yeah, leadership and missions has a lot of admin. And when the internet was invented and became popular in the 90s with email and websites and then YouTube and then videoing and editing videos and communication, photography, that all became a part of missions as well. Really a dream come true. And so starting worrying about doing evangelism only later became leadership, admin, and evangelism. So the discovering of gifts and the merging of them, the sinking of your different gifts and learning to say no to different offers so that your energies and your investments are more hitting the mark rather than, you know, shooting at everything. You're hitting the mark more clearly once you discover what you're good at. So that takes years to discover, and that's been quite fulfilling. Okay, number 7. How do you support yourself as a missionary? Well, in the beginning, I started with $5,000 in my savings account and a word of the Lord to go. And as that savings began to run out, after about 2.5 years, I started getting these letters in the mail. Oh, Brother Mitch, we like what you're doing, you know, and keep up the good work. And here's some money for you. We hope we can send again in the future. And so God has really provided faithfully for myself and my family. My daughters went to expensive private schools, sponsored and supported by different families around the world. I own my house. I own my vehicles. People have given me cars, lent me cars. And, you know, from 28 countries to all 50 states, God has provided faithfully, all from that startup of 5,000 and a word of the Lord to go, and God has really multiplied that. So, amen. That's how we support ourselves in missions, like every other youth with a mission worker. And there's about 30,000 minimum of us around the world in every nation. None of us are salaried. Everybody has to trust God for their regular needs, raising their support from friends, church people, anybody that is interested in what we're doing. Okay, number 8, what advice can you give to a person who is considering becoming a missionary? If you are considering becoming a missionary, serve where you are. Yeah, that's the main one. Serve where you are. Whatever your job is, whatever your career is, whether you're at McDonald's or a nurse or a construction worker, be involved in a local church, be in the streets for evangelism, volunteer at the local, you know, ministry or whatever. And so serve where you are is the key. It's not about going overseas, but you are to be a missionary where you are. I wish I could spend more time on just that one. But serve where you are, start where you're at, and that God will, you know, lead you and guide you and show you your next step. Matter of fact, it's not so difficult for God to direct you and to guide you when you're already on the move, on the go. Yeah, like my name, Go Mitch. Amen. Yeah, when you're going, it's easier for God to, you know, direct you because you're already on the move. Amen. So serve where you are, volunteer, go out, join local ministries, launch out from there, develop your relationships there, communicate your plans. Like if you're interested in a certain place, like, oh, you're interested in Guatemala, or you're interested in Spain, or you're interested in Italy, or you're interested in Papua New Guinea, you know, talk to your pastor about that. Talk to your church members. Say, I'm interested in Papua New Guinea, and I'm thinking about it. And start reading about it, watching videos about it. And then when you have an opportunity, make a short-term trip there. Visit that country of your interest. Amen. You'll never, never, never lose by traveling and visiting these countries. Period. For sure. Absolutely. It's never a wasted trip. And so, amen. Next question. Number 9, how do you think someone can receive the confirmation from God from what you have observed from yours and others' experiences? How do you think someone can receive the confirmation from God? Well, for sure you need to learn to hear God's voice, and he'll speak to you however he speaks to you that you understand, yeah? Some people through dreams, some people through scripture, some people through the pastor, some people through an experience or a circumstance. God speaks to us in thousands of ways, and we just need to be listening. And he spoke to me through a map on the wall. He spoke to me when I was folding literature. He spoke to me through one verse. And then he spoke to me through a tourism brochure, like I told you earlier, about missions and about going. And then he just confirmed it with my leaders and my adult peers that were around me during that time. And the timing had to be right. Matter of fact, he was speaking to me about missions and about launching out, but I still had to wait 2.5 years for my military contract to finish. And then I worked in a church for 5 months while I was waiting for my discipleship school to start. So really I had 3 years of preparing and saving and waiting to get on that airplane. So timing has to be right also. Number 10, have you or do you ever feel like giving up in doing mission? No, giving up has never been an issue for me. Even as a non-Christian, as a non-believer in my old days, You know, I was always competitive and quite success and victory driven, and I love winning. And you know, so my personality, my natural personality type, is very overcomish. But not in giving up, but attractive offers is often an issue, where I know that if I was in a career or in a business venture, I could prosper and earn wealth and create wealth in a short amount of time, probably, if I did not do what I'm doing ministerially and just focused on whatever this business would be. And I know that that would be a success. And so for me, it's not about giving up has ever been an issue, but the attraction, the attractive offers, or the attractive other possibilities. But that's long gone, basically. I'm 60 now. I've been on the field for 36 years, so I don't expect very big changes coming up anytime soon. Number 11. And the last question, actually. Here we go. Name a few different ways people can help missionary leaders and organizations. Well, you probably know the first two that I'm going to say by default. Of course, pray for our missionaries, pray for those on the field, give as you're able, supporting them financially any way that you can, one time, regularly, quarterly, annually, or for certain projects that they're raising money for. This is one way. But the one I want to really emphasize, if you really want to help them and partner with them and join with them, is visit them. Yeah. We call it vacation with a purpose. You know, most working career business people, you get 2 weeks of vacation a time, or sometimes you get 1 month of vacation every year, 2 weeks and then another 2 weeks. Rather than going to Disneyland or Hollywood or some kind of a traditional camping trip or whatever, why not go on a short-term mission trip? Yeah. I remember my pastor in South Dakota, he once came to the Philippines to do all of his dental work, because it's cheaper to do dental work in the Philippines than in America, and he'll still save a lot of money. So he came here to do his dental work, and in his free time, he was volunteering and helping and joining us at our training center. And so it was a life-changing time for him. It was a, you know, he hit many birds with one stone. He finished his dental thing, and he also experienced the mission field with us. Now he knows what we're really doing, and it helped our relationship and his preaching and his teaching in the future and in the present with his experiences that he gained while he was with us. That's what you can do. Take your vacation with a purpose. I used to do this even when I was in the military. They used to give us 30 days a year. And I used to take 2 weeks at a time, and I would travel across America with a Navy friend, and we would pass out New Testaments, we would pass out literature, we would preach, we would do evangelism in parking lots. I remember visiting the Salvation Army in Chicago, and we visited a teen challenge in Stuyvesant, New York, Brooklyn, New York, and we were baptizing new converts in South Dakota, and then we would drive back to North Carolina. So we took our vacation with a purpose, and what a great, great, great thing to do. And that's how you can serve your friends on the field, your missionary friends on the field, by joining them, by visiting them. That's what you can do. So God bless you. Thank you for asking the questions, and I hope this helps you. And again, you can find me on YouTube at GoMitch2, and on Facebook at the same channel. And amen. Consider giving to our ministry and joining us in the future. Amen. God bless you. Thank you.